Good afternoon. As we were still with superconductivity, though this session was supposed to be on optics, we will carry on with superconductivity for some time, and if we still have time, then we'll begin at least the elements of optics. But as before, I'll start with questions that came in. Point is this, that this is a question which came from 1241 NRI Institute of Information Science and Technology at Bhopal. The question is that what is the use of persistent current in daily life? Well, let me try to answer that question, but I can't talk about daily life because superconductivity doesn't appear in daily life. But basically the question is, you are asking that what good is persistent current? Can you use it for anything? So this is something which one can actually answer. The thing is connected with, so let us just recall what was persistent current. So if you remember that we talked about Meissner effect, which is an important tool, which says that the magnetic flux cannot enter a sample. Now, if the magnetic flux cannot enter a superconducting sample, in case I have a sample in the shape of a donut or a ring or tube or whatever, then what we said is that the flux lines cannot enter the material of the sample. But the problem is that supposing there were flux lines in the semiconductor in the beginning, in the superconductor in the beginning, then I lowered the temperature, finally withdrew the magnetic field. I said that magnetic flux gets trapped. The magnetic flux gets trapped because the flux lines which had entered the hole cannot get out. Okay. Now, this Meissner effect and the persistent current is known to have particularly those which are in type 2 superconductors, not so much. See, the full Meissner effect does not have that much of a utility. Also primarily, and it is not too bad a thing, because as you know, type 1 superconductors, the typical critical temperatures are of the order of maximum 9K for niobium can go to about 23K for a particular alloy. So, we are not particularly unhappy about that. So, what we are talking about is that if you take a type 2 superconductor, as I told you, in that there are these vortex tubes which are essentially tubes of normal region. Now, there is a thing called flux pinning. Now, you must have heard of something called a magnetic levitation. Now, remember what is magnetic levitation? One of course hears a lot about magnetic levitation. Many of you might have seen an experiment which is taking a small, today it is small, but small magnet in the shape of a ring or things like that, and putting it above a magnetic field, directly opposite a magnetic field, and then you can see that it actually stays afloat without anything. And the primary reason is the following, that if I have a type 2 superconductors, then if there is a magnetic field which you are putting from below, then this magnetic field will not be able to enter the specimen of the sample. And so as a result, what will happen is that in order to keep those fluxes out, the superconductor will generate its own current. This is not really called a persistent current, but similar to it, which will essentially repel these fluxes. So then it is like having, so that face of the magnet superconductor which is facing the magnetic field pole will behave like a like pole. because it is opposing the flux that is coming in. And as you know, two similar poles always repel each other. So as a result, the in order to keep the flux pinned, because its pinning occurs because of impurities generally, and these flux tubes cannot move around. And as a result of that, the levitation can take place. And the levitation in principle has a lot of applications later, but certainly not a day-to-day application. Okay. Next question, 1150 and many others, like which properties of superconductor is focused or improved to develop room temperature superconductor. I told you in the morning, I told you there is nothing like a given prescription. It is essentially like medicine. You try out various materials, try out various properties and find out that something works. So that question is not going to be answered. Another question, though I answered it in the morning, but it kept on coming back. This was asked in this session and last session, Charotar University, Nadiad, what is red electron? In fact, this question was asked even last session with Professor Suresh, somebody asked, what is a super electron? Let me make something very clear again and again. There is nothing like a red electron, there is nothing like a green electron, there are only electrons. Okay? What I told you is that in order to explain some things, not on the basis of Cooper pair or the quantum mechanics, we sometimes have what is known as a phenomenological theory. So in that phenomenological theory, we had assumed that London assumption, that supposing I assume there are two types of electrons with different property of transport. One type of property, which just out of illustration, I called it red electron, another is green electron. I mean, I didn't really mean that you people will take it very seriously. Remember, I also told you a Cooper pair, assume that these two electrons are married. Now, don't tell me that which code did they go to and all that. I mean, obviously, that's not correct. Sometimes when you are talking, giving a simile, it doesn't mean it has to be taken that seriously. What I meant by saying that two electrons are married is to say they remain together. Of course, nowadays not even married people remain together, but that's a different story. But what I am trying to tell you is this, that supposing there are two categories of electrons with different transport properties, one which obeys, which dissipates, one which dissipates energy, the other one flows without resistance. Okay? The one which flows without resistance, we will call it is what I said, or rather London call it the superfluid electron or a super electron. Okay? That doesn't mean that there are electrons called super electrons or red electron or green electron. I am sure this question will not come up again. All right. Next question is, again we have been talking about it in case of a superconductor. This is 1127 Vishwakarma Institute, Pune. Why is the current on the surface or the edges? Well, this is true for any conductor. Now, mind you, if I am passing a current through it, that's a different story. But I am trying to say that if you are establishing a current without a battery, you say when a battery is connected, you know that there is a source of EMF which is providing the current, right? Now, so therefore, that is not a problem at all. If I connect a conducting wire to a battery, the steady current passes through it. That is because there is a source of that current which is providing the charge. There is another sink which is removing the charge continuously. So that is not what we are talking about. We are talking about that when you have a superconductor, you have established a flux, then withdrawn a magnetic field. There is neither a battery nor a magnetic field to keep the flux. Now, so there is a magnetic field generated in the hole of the ring, which remains. I told you also flux gets trapped, but I am coming back to it again. So in order that that can happen, a current must flow. Now, such a current cannot flow inside the material. It has to be contained only on the surface. And you remember we talked about that surfaces discontinuities behave separately when we talked about boundary conditions and all that. So inside the bulk material there cannot be a current. So current must flow within a very thin sheath of the layer, and that is what generates its own magnetic field in order to keep this flux lines. So that is, and that I said is quantized, right. 1150 Sau Sushila had asked, how are type 2 conductors helpful? Type 2 conductors are the ones which are going to become technologically the most important things, because any property of superconductor that you can think of. For example, suppose you want to use, somebody asked in the morning, what happens if I connect a part of a circuit by means of a superconducting wire? And my answer at that time was, today nothing happens because your circuits are small. But supposing you are looking at a science fiction and you say that I want to transport power without loss from generating station to somewhere else, and supposing I had a superconducting material which remained superconductor at normal temperature or even Bombay Delhi temperature, then what it means is that it can carry current without any loss at all on the way. Now that would then be a real practical application. Now, and if at all such a thing can be done, whether at a laboratory scale or at a industrial scale, then it will have to be for type 2 superconductors, because only in type 2 superconductors our chances of getting an increased critical temperature is substantial. But type 1 superconductors that way are very useless. But the other example that I told you, if you are thinking in terms of, for example, magnetic levitation, you need to have these normal regions inside that where the flux gets pinned. It is required, because the it is only in the normal region in the superconductor that you can have the flux tubes. And so the pinned flux can only happen in type 2 superconductors, because in type 1 either the magnetic field enters completely or it does not. This question 1241, what are phonons? Strictly it doesn't fall into the scope of my lectures, but since a question has been asked and I use the word phonon, let me give a one line answer to that. See, the thing is that generally any material, any matter, insulators or anything, it has these ion cores, and of course there are electrons. The ion cores are generally in a lattice structure. Now what happens is, when you apply, when you subject it to a temperature, because of the thermal energy that these ions absorb, the ions start vibrating about their mean position. But the point is this, that because of the forces, interatomic forces, these ions simply do not move away from each other. These are actually like they are connected by a spring, and so they can move a little bit from their equilibrium position and again come back and so vibrate. Now, so in other words, I have ions which can vibrate. Now, if you remember that we did in our, we talk about simple harmonic motion of a spring and a mass. Now, we solve the problem of spin, spring and a mass in classical physics. We talk about that there will be amplitudes, it will show simple harmonic motion and things like that. But then you do the same problem in quantum mechanics, it becomes a linear harmonic oscillator. And in the linear harmonic oscillator, your energy states get quantized, which was not true in this. Here all that happened is that you said that the energy is constant, kinetic energy becomes potential energy becomes kinetic energy, and it keeps on continuing there. So when you quantize a thing, the go from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics, certain quantization takes place. Usually it is in the form of discretization of the energy. Energy gets discretized. Now, if these lattice vibrations that you have got, you worked in the theory of quantum mechanics, instead of having a collection of simple harmonic oscillators, what you have is a collection of quantum oscillators. And this vibration which is quantized. This is called phonon. So in other words, to give you a one line answer to that question, the quantized vibrations of the ions in a solid are called phonons. What is the typical distance between two Cooper pairs of electron? Is it consistent with electron potential versus distance plot from Netaji Subhash Engineering College, Godia, Kolkata? Let me come back to this question a little bit. So the point is this, that morning I talked about the concept of a Cooper pair, and I said that basically the Cooper pairs, I mean, you can imagine that the phonons are providing something like a spring between these two electrons. So that those two electrons, irrespective of how far they are, okay, they would still continue to travel together. Now, what actually happens is this, that the distance between the two electrons, which are connected by the ionic vibrations, that is the phonons as we call it, that can be reasonably large. Now, incidentally, I have to sort of tell you what is meant by a reasonably large in that context. But if you take different Cooper pairs, because these Cooper pairs, they can come fairly close to each other, so there is no problem. So in other words, the individual members of a Cooper pair can be far apart. I will explain what is meant by far apart. But the different, you know, you can have a collection of a large number of Cooper pairs in the same assembly. Now, in order to understand this, you remember I told you that the electrons which participate in this have to remain within a small distance of the Fermi level. See, in fact, this picture I had given you, that I have a Fermi surface, and I am saying that basically this electron and that electron, this is k, this is minus k. So this must lie within EF plus or minus kT, Fermi energy plus or minus kT. These are the electrons which are subjected, I mean, which are going to form pairs. And the reason is very simple, because otherwise that thermal energy will destroy them. The thermal energy, you realize, see, I told you already that the gap of the superconductor is that this delta is typically given by 1.76, this is Bcs theory, 1.76 times KTC. And so this is typically 1 milli electron volts, or even a fraction of a milli electron volt, 0.121 milli electron volts. So now, so therefore the electrons which are close to the, near the Fermi surface, they are the ones which will participate in it. Now, if you look at the energy uncertainty of such a thing, because these electrons were really free electrons, so I have essentially p square by 2m as their energy. So therefore, the energy uncertainty, if you like, so this is, you just differentiate this, you get p delta p divided by m. Now, this is approximately an expression for your delta, because remember what I told you, I said delta is the energy by which the Cooper pair is makes the Fermi C unstable. In other words, the energy of the Cooper pair is lower than the energy of the metallic things, and that is what opens up a gap. So therefore, if my gap delta is p delta p, and let me use dp because there are too many deltas coming in, over m. Now, in that case, if you use uncertainty principle, then the uncertainty in the position of these pair, so in other words, what is the distance by which they can be there? See, if I know the momentum uncertainty, then I can find out the, I know already what is the maximum uncertainty of momentum, so I know how far these two could be away. So this zeta then is given by the momentum position uncertainty, which tells me this is equal to, again let me use dp instead of delta p, okay. So zeta naught equal to h cross by dp. But then this is equal to, say the, you use this, so this quantity, I can immediately tell you that this is nothing but H cross, okay, by dP. Let me multiply this with a velocity, Fermi velocity here, and denominator also let me multiply with the Fermi velocity. So look at what is happening then. So here what I have got is H cross Vf by dP Vf, okay, and P by M is nothing but the velocity of the electron, which is approximately equal to, this is a hand waving calculation, the velocity of the electrons multiplied by dP. So therefore, what I got here is essentially H cross divided by delta, because this is dP Vf and I have got, so P by M is, so this delta is dP, Vf times dP, so this is what my H cross by delta is. In BCS theory, though I have done it with a lot of hand waving, it turns out that almost similar expression is obtained by BCS with the change that this works out to this time delta into pi, just a small factor is there. Now you can use this expression or this expression to calculate what should be the value of zeta. You can see immediately you have your H cross, which is typically of the order of 10 to the power minus 34 or so. You have a delta, I told you typical delta is about a milli electron volt, let us say 10 to the power minus 3 or 10 to the power minus 4 electron volts. So, but this is an electron volt unit, this is in joule second, this is in SI unit, sorry, minus 4. So therefore, I need to multiply this with this thing, your 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 there, and I have forgotten a Vf to be carried in here, okay. So there is Vf there, all right. Now what is the Fermi velocity? Typical velocity of electron corresponding to Fermi energy of a metal, okay, 4 or 5 electron volts, is about, you know, about electron speed is about 10 to the power 5 meters per second. Take all these numbers, you can see what is happening here. So I have a 10 to the power minus 19 and 4, so minus 23 and 5, that is 28, so it is about 10 to the power minus 6 by 1.6 is there, let us ignore it because I have taken it exactly as 10 to the power minus 4. So this tells me my zeta is typically 1 micrometer or so, of that order. So this is what is the typical coherence length in case of the type of theory we are talking about. The measurements indicate roughly similar values, and so that is there. So that is what tells us what it is. Then having done that, why do various superconductors have different TC from South Sushila? I don't know, these are material properties. See, as I told you in the morning also, the substances have properties depending upon a lot of complicated things. There is no great theory to explain them, all right. Once again, repeated question on from same show Sushila on what do you do to get room temperature superconductors? Well, alchemy, as I told you in the morning. What are phonons? Repeated again. So I will KS Rangaswamy College of Engineering 1313 asks a question that how long the persistent current will exist? How long persistent current will exist? See, the thing is, there are two issues there. One is that there are theoretical prediction on if you have established a flux in a ring, how long will it exist? And they sort of depend upon to what extent you have been able to measure some of the quantities. The theoretical estimate seems to suggest that you will have literally billions of years for which it will persist. But as I told you, one can't wait for a billion year to check whether you are right or not. But people have tested in the laboratory for a period of up to 1 year, okay, and they have not found any reduction in the persistent current. So theoretically, the persistent current should stay on forever. If you want to put a limit on it, today's limit is that it will stay for 10 to the power 15 years. But as I said, that this is the situation there. other than Mercury and 1128 Visveswarya National Institute of Technology Nagpur, other than Mercury and liquid helium, well, liquid helium is a bad example, what are the other superconducting materials? Let me be very clear, literally today there are thousands of superconducting materials. So I can't obviously give you a list, okay? But if you are looking at type 1, see, the in elemental superconductor, niobium with something like 9.2, niobium with 9.3 degrees is the maximum among the elements. There are others, for example, lead has 7.2 degrees Kelvin. These are all in Kelvins. I will have something like, aluminum, for example, is 1.17. You notice the better a conductor is, things are becoming smaller. Tin has 3.7. Mercury, of course, we have been talking about 4 degrees or so, 4.15 degrees. Similarly, it goes on and on. In the type 2B, the new type of superconductors, we have, for example, the first major one, yttrium barium copper oxide, IBCO, it has 92 Kelvin, but we are sort of roughly, Professor Suresh will be able to tell you better, we are still talking in terms of 125 to 130 degrees being about the highest temperature achieved in the laboratories, but you know, which are steady. So therefore, there are very large number of them. Then 1043 is a good question, I will take a bit of a time. 1043, which is Sarvajanik College of Engineering Technology, Surat, what will be the magnitude of persistent current? How big is persistent current? Good question, but let's look at it a little more carefully. See, this is a very interesting calculation, you can do it. It depends upon what is it that, you know, for what geometry you want your persistent current. So let me give you a quick example. I am saying that, let me say the following. Supposing I have taken a sample in the form of a ring. And what I have done is to, and this ring, let us suppose I have taken a radius of 1 centimeter. Now I establish a magnetic field. Remember the persistent current again, how it works. You first let the flux lines go in, and then, you know, this is at normal temperature, reduce the temperature. When it becomes a superconductor, then I know that this is what will happen. This is the expulsion of flux. And through the holes, of course, there would be flux lines. So this is when T is less than Tc, but the magnetic field is still there, B not equal to 0 or H not equal to 0. Now when you now withdraw the field, then I pointed out that these will go away. These will go away because there is no magnetic field to sustain them. But these flux lines, which were here for example, now they get trapped. This is the trapping of the flux. They get trapped, and because there is nowhere to go, they just close on themselves. Now what I also told you is, what has been found is that these flux lines are quantized in units of H by 2E. So my phi naught, my flux that is there, has to be a number n times H by 2E. Now if you calculate what is H by 2E, this works out to 2 into 10 to the power minus 15, okay, Tesla meter square. This is my phi naught. This is simple. Just take the value of H, take the value of E, multiply them, divide them. Okay, so in other words, the flux that is there contained inside that hole it has to be in units of phi naught. So whatever number of, now let me just calculate what is the situation if I want only one flux lines to be enclosed. Now I have told you that my ring has a radius of 1 centimeter. So my area of that ring, area of that hole if you like, is pi r square. So it is pi into 1 centimeter square, which is 10 to the power minus 4 meter square. Now, well, since I am doing a rough calculation, forget about this, let me take the area to be equal to 10 to the power minus 4 meter square. You can put all those pi's and things like that. Okay. Now, if this is your situation, that for a single fluxoid, my phi naught value is 2 into 10 to the power minus 15 Tesla meter square, and the area of my enclosed is, as I said, I am taking it as, well, there is a pi, so let me take it as 3 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter square. Then my this is my unit of flux, this is my area, so the magnetic field strength that is there, the B itself, you remember B is nothing but phi naught by the area. So therefore, this is 2 into 10 to the power minus 15 divided by 2 or 3, it does not matter because calculations are not exact. So this is of the order of 10 to the power minus 11, okay, your Tesla. This is my flux. Okay. Now the question that I have to ask is, what is the current that I must have in order to maintain this strength of the field? For that, I go back to my electricity magnetism again and look at the expression for field in the center of a circle, let us say. I mean, it does not have to be, but this sort of give you rough idea. So if you recall your first year physics, then you will see that if I radius of my circle is r, then the field at the center is given by mu 0 I by 2r. This is a circle, its center is given like this. So this quantity is 10 to the power minus 11 Tesla. Now look at what this means. As you know, mu 0 is 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7, I is something I am looking for, 2r I have said it has 1 centimeter, so it is 10 to the power minus 2 is equal to 10 to the power minus 11. So if you look at this I, forgetting about these factors, what I get is 10 to the power 6, because this 10 to the power minus 2 there, minus 11 there, so 10 to the power minus 14, 13 divided by 10 to the power minus 6. So 10 to the power minus 6. So in other words, due to a single fluxoid, the type of, this is in amperes, type of persistent current that I need is microampere. But you remember my explanation. I said this is the current I require for maintaining a magnetic flux, single magnetic flux. But of course, within that hole there is not going to be a single magnetic flux. I will have more, right? Because, and typically, if you look at a typical sample of that size, we may have as many as 10 to the power 6, n may be about 10 to the power 6 fluxes, flux lines. So in order to get that, the persistent current that you would need would be of the order of an ampere or so. So since the strength of the current depends upon how much of flux that you put in, it would also depend upon what was the strength of the magnetic field that you had used to generate these fluxes. So supposing originally I had inserted a 1 Tesla magnetic field. 1 Tesla incidentally is a very strong magnetic field. Normal laboratory magnetic fields that you have will be a Gauss or so, or maybe 10 Gauss. 10 Gauss is 10 to the power minus 3 Tesla. So take for example a strength like 10 to the power minus 3 Tesla. You have now withdrawn the magnetic field and a strength of 10 to the power minus 3 Tesla has to be preserved. Find out the flux now. That is very easy. Area of your sample multiplied by the magnetic field. So once you have found out that flux, okay, just use the standard formula for magnetic field in a circular domain. which is mu 0 I by 2 I. This is rough way of determining what it is, but as I said, the answer depends upon what was your original strength of the magnetic field, which you had later on withdrawn. So we are talking about things which could be small, could be milliamperes, depending upon if it is a weak field, but for the laboratory field, it could be as much as a, it's not a small current, it could be as much as an ampere. Okay, let me clarify this. What is the difference between, this is came from some Gitam University, 1295 Gitam University, yes, Hyderabad. The question is, what is the difference between a persistent current and an eddy current? Well, you know, this question is not as bad as it sounds, because the source of both of them are the same. The how did eddy current arise? The eddy current arose because of changing magnetic field. If you have a conductor, you need conductors, of course. If you have a conductor and you are trying to change the flux through it, right, it will generate its own current on the surfaces. And this direction of the current would be perpendicular to the direction in which you have put in the magnetic field. And these are eddy currents, which are the difference is these eddy currents, because of the fact that they are in a normal medium, they are also dissipative. So they dissipate energy, and one has to take care of eddy losses when you talk about electrical parts. And so if you like, the persistent current arose from similar requirement, okay, because when we withdraw the magnetic field, but the origin is slightly different. When you withdraw the magnetic field, you are changing the flux, but that is not the reason why it came in. The origin was different. The reason why persistent current came in is there was flux which was trapped, and because of Meissner effect, it couldn't enter, it couldn't get out, okay. So there is a similarity, but not much, right. I think what I will do is, because I have taken my usual quota of half an hour for your questions, I will try to, you know, please don't send the same question again and again, because this is what is happening, because it takes us a lot of time to throw away. For example, what is a phonon? I have received twice. So similar questions are coming twice, thrice. It takes a lot of our time, you know. And sometimes I have already answered that question. Like in the morning, I answered the question which was asked by Mahakal Institute of Technology, Ujjain, how is superconductivity related to magnetism? I told you why the modern, the conventional superconductors exclude the possibility of becoming a ferromagnet, because I expect the ground state to be a singlet, whereas ferromagnet requires the spins to be aligned. Okay, we proceed with our discussion of in the morning. So I told you about the Cooper's pair. I would try to finish this session today. So what I said is that I have a wave function for the pair of electrons, and I sort of proved to told you that look, this wave function can be split into an even part and an odd part, but since I want the wave function not to be 0 when two electrons sit one over the other, okay, then I can't have a sine function there, because if R1 is equal to R2, this is 0. And so therefore, only the even functions are acceptable. So if the function, the space part of the function is even, then my spin part must be antisymmetric, that it must be a singlet. So I made two or three statements about the Cooper pairs. One is what we said is, these are electrons, its origin is phonon mediated attractive interaction. So if you like, what we are talking about is, imagine a picture of two electrons bound to each other by a spring. Now tomorrow don't ask me that where is that spring. See, these are all similes being given. I assume that if there are two masses connected by a spring, they remain together, okay. So it is only in that connection that I said that connected by a spring. So what is actually happening is this, that the two electrons continually exchange a phonon, and it is in this way. A better example would be something like this, that supposing on a ground I have two players. Now, and let us suppose they are throwing a ball towards each other. Now, so A throws a ball towards B, B receives, catches it, B throws it back. Now, remember, during the process, the two people A and B could be moving, and this you have seen happening if you have gone to any cricket practice or things like that, you have seen it happening regularly, that a player throws a ball towards another, he returns back, but in the process they are always moving around. It is not that they are just doing that practice staying in one place. So, in that case, these two people that I talk to you who are continuously exchanging the ball, they can be considered to be a pair. Okay? And this is the model, this is the picture that I use for our superconducting pair, where what we are saying is that imagine that electron number 1 and electron number 2, they continuously exchange a phonon. Remember I told you phonon is the quantized lattice vibration. So, they continuously do a phonon. Now, this pair, it remains as a pair. It turns out its statistics is Bose-Einstein statistics. And from what I could understand when I came in towards the end of Professor Suresh's lecture, that he told you that it is the bosons which can undergo Einstein condensation. The condensation means simply, this is not condensation in the sense of the vapor condensing. It is a condensation meaning that these objects, the bosons, they all come to the same state, same momentum state. So, Cooper pairs are collections of bosons, and I have said that theoretically, the I did a calculation. Now, here is the actual numbers. You can see that I did a calculation of 1.6 micrometer. I mean, I did a calculation of 1 micrometer, and coherence length for aluminum happens to be 1.6 micrometer. And it is as low as 40 nanometer for niobium. Now, you can see immediately that there is a relationship because this has a higher critical temperature than that one. Okay. So, we also made a statement that the superconducting state is separated from the normal state by an energy gap of the order of about 0.1 milli electron volts. Okay. And this gap you can verify by typical tunneling experiments. Okay. And of course, a specific heat is a direct example of the existence of a gap. You know that specific heat when it goes exponentially, like it happens in case of a semiconductor, it is evidence of a gap. So, and not only that, the if you look at, remember some time back somebody asked me a question, why do you keep on talking about DC resistance? What are the resistances there? You see, there is something called AC resistance also. The thing is that if you are subjecting the sample to an AC having a particular type of frequency, then it is possible that it is able to take care of this energy gap. So, the existence of energy gap can be inferred from various experiments. And as I said, this is typically of the order of a fraction of a milli electron volts. So, this is the picture of density of state versus the energy, and here is the Fermi energy. Now, remember somebody was asking Professor Suresh towards the end, where is the Fermi energy for an insulator or a semiconductor? Well, there is a, I mean, in one line I will tell you that Fermi energy at zero temperature for a metal has the interpretation that it is the energy of the highest occupied level. This is not true, this definition is not true for the case of a semiconductor or an insulator. Now, what we do in case of a semiconductor insulator is to define the Fermi energy or a chemical potential to be that energy at which the probability of occupation becomes half. And if you look at the expression for the Fermi energy in the Fermi Dirac statistics, you will find it is 1 over 1 plus e to the power epsilon minus mu by kT. So, if your epsilon is equal to mu, that is Fermi energy, the denominator becomes equal to 2, so that the fraction is 1 by 2. So, it does not have that interpretation, and for an intrinsic semiconductor, the Fermi energy lies exactly in the middle of the gap. Okay. So, I told you just before we concluded last session that the wave function of the Cooper pair can be considered to satisfy the Schrodinger equation. So, I have written it down, there is a minus sign problem here. But otherwise, all that I have done is to write down P square by 2m plus, well, E star at this moment is the Cooper pair charge, which is 2E, phi is a potential, scalar potential, A is the vector potential, and this is minus I h cross del by 2m is P by 2m essentially, P square by 2m because there is square, but P becomes P minus E A in this model. So, this is nothing, you can write down this equation. Now, only difference that I am doing now is the following. I am saying that my Cooper pairs are bosons, and so therefore, the in the lowest state, all the pairs must have the same momentum, and that momentum is 0. Because you see, had it been fermions, I will not be allowed to do it. Because once a particular momentum state is occupied, the next pair cannot occupy that. Because, so what we are trying to say now is, but that is not true now, because I can have any number of Cooper pairs in the same state of momentum. So, let us put all of them there, and that must be the lowest. So, typically it is the, since the amplitude is square root of the probability density, so the lowest level, if its occupancy is n, it is you know, higher by a factor of square root of n with respect to any other level. So, the wave function, now this is not a wave function of a single electron, this is not wave function of a Cooper pair, this is the type of wave function where I am saying, this is a macroscopic wave function. This is a wave function of, let us say, the whole assembly of my Cooper pairs. So, I write this because I know a wave function is an amplitude which can be in principle a complex number. So, I write it as square root of rho, so that psi star psi is essentially rho, rho has the interpretation of density, times a phase factor which is e to the power I theta r, and both of them are real by definition. So, if I substitute this into the expression for the probability current density, which is psi star psi plus, you know, I h cross minus I h cross del psi star psi plus complex conjugate, you get, this requires a little bit of an algebra, you get an expression like this, h cross by m delta theta minus q by h a this. Now, inside the superconductor, well, inside the superconductor, I do not have a current. So, therefore, this is 0, current density is 0, which means my delta theta is q by h a. Now, this is what I am trying to do is, remember in the morning, I worked out the flux quantization assuming Bohr-Sommerfeld model. We said that if a charge is moving, accelerating in a circle, I must use Bohr condition, because otherwise my charge will radiate and finally slow down and stop. Now, here I am doing the same thing, but using my ideas of quantum mechanics. So, I am saying that this wave function that is there, this wave function that is there has to be single valued, because at the same point I cannot have two values for the wave function. Now, what is meant by single valued? Supposing you start here. Now, when you start here, now go round the circle, you come back. When you come back, you have increased theta by 2 pi. So, since it is still the same point, then your wave function, in order that it is single valued, it tells me if you change theta by 2 pi, 4 pi, whatever, multiple of 2 pi, 6 pi, then you must come back to the same point, right. So, theta when it changes by 2 n pi, this is what it is. Now, since my inside the material, my current density is 0. So, probability current is 0. So, my delta theta is q by h a, which is what I did here. This quantity is 0. So, therefore, this is what happens. Okay. So, write that. Now, what you do is you realize by Stokes theorem, line integral of a dot dl is nothing but surface integral of the magnetic field, which is my flux. So, that is the confirmation that my flux. Now, how did it come from? Here, when I did the integral over d theta, I said my theta can change because of the single valued condition, the line integral of d theta in a closed contour must be 2 n pi. So, my phi must be n h by q. I told you I am using q here, so that I do not confuse you with that star which is a complex conjugate. This q happens to be equal to 2 e, and this is the flux quantization condition. Okay. With that, Let me spend the remaining 15 minutes, if you like, by telling you a very interesting effect, which incidentally probably has a very huge potential of an industrial application, namely the Josephson junction. You have all heard of squid and things like that, namely the Josephson junction. Okay, so let me continue with this. So what is a Josephson junction? In this situation, I have, this is typical experiments of tunneling that you have seen in provides a barrier and all that, but there is a difference. I have on two sides of an insulator, thin insulator, a superconductor on this side S1, superconductor on that side S2. Now what I do is this, that the two superconductors are separated by a thin layer of insulator. Now remember, normally that if I now connect the two ends of the superconductor with a battery, now if this insulator is thick, I do not expect any current to go through, because you know, I mean, an insulator does not allow the motion of charges. So let me look at what is happening, what is when this insulator is thin, so that a tunneling effect is expected. But you will find something very interesting here. Supposing the left hand side I denote by psi 1, its bulk wave function, and for the right hand side I have a psi 2. Let us assume there is no magnetic field. Now what are these two amplitudes? These two amplitudes are, I have on the left hand side psi 1, I write it as square root of rho 1 e to the power I theta 1. On the right hand side I have got psi 2, which I write at square root of rho 2 e to the power I theta 2. Now using this, let me write down a very simple Schrodinger equation. Remember that supposing there were no connectivity between the two, supposing I take this by itself, then my Schrodinger equation for psi 1 is I h cross d psi 1 by dt is E psi, okay. And so let us say E1 psi or U1 psi, does not matter. Now the equation for this one is I h cross d psi 2 by dt is U2 psi. Now what I now have, so I have got this, forget about this for a moment. So I have got these two superconductors, but there is a coupling of psi 1 to psi 2 because of this reason, that this one has an effect because of the fact that on the other side there is another wave function, okay. Let me take a simple model. In simple model I say that look, if when you are writing the equation of motion for psi 1, that is Schrodinger equation for psi 1, there is add to it a potential term which is due to psi 2 and vice versa. Now let us call it a coupling term, and I will assume coupling to be symmetric. So I h cross d psi 1 by dt is U1 psi 1, U1 is the energy of the left hand side in the absence of any coupling, plus k times psi 2. So equation for psi 1 has a contribution from psi 2. Likewise, the symmetric equation for psi 2 has a contribution from psi 1. So this is my pair of equations which govern this situation. Incidentally, I must point out that this beautiful derivation without very rigorous mathematics is due to Richard Feynman, and I would urge all of you that please read a very nice article on Josephson junction, which I am following for this particular part of my lecture, which is in Feynman Lectures, volume 3, chapter 21. So as I said, k represents the coupling between two junctions. Now if k is equal to 0, then the equations describe each superconductor with lowest energy, and these are U1 and U2. So what I am doing now is this, suppose we connect, look at it, suppose we connect the two ends of the superconductor to terminals of a battery, so that there is a potential difference of V between them. Remember, a battery will maintain the energy difference as V, which means U1 minus U2 is equal to V. I can take the zero of the energy halfway through. Now if I do that, then my first equation, look at what I am doing. I said U1 minus U2 is the battery potential. That is what I want to keep it. But I measure the energy from the middle of this. Now, if I do that, then one of them is higher by V, the other one is lower by V. So, that is what I have done. I have said I h cross d psi 1 by dt is q, which is again your charge, q V by 2 psi 1 plus k psi 2, and I h cross d psi 2 by dt is minus q V by 2, because I have taken the origin to be at the center, plus k psi 1. Now, I need to solve this pair of equations. Now, what do I do? So, what I do in this case is, I substitute rho 1 equal to psi 1 equal to square root of rho 1 e to the power I theta 1. This is the form I gave you earlier. Psi 2 is equal to square root of rho 2 e to the power I theta 2. Now, I need to do a little bit of an algebra to tell you how to get the equation that is there. So, for a moment, I will go over to this, and I will not work out the complete equation, but let me sort of at least do a part of that equation. Now, I am copying this equation on my pad so that I can tell you what to do with these equations. Yeah. So, these are the pairs of equation I had, and I said that let us do the following. Let us write psi 1 equal to square root of rho 1, this is the for the left hand side, e to the power I theta 1. This is trivial algebra, but I will not have it in my notes, so therefore, I am telling you how to do it. Now, so look at what do I get. Let me do just one equation first. So, because the second equation can then be written down from symmetry. So, I have I h cross, I need d psi 1 by dt. Now, both rho 1 and theta 1 can vary with time. So, I have got first one is d by dt of square root of rho 1, which is half denominator rho 1 dot, because d by dt of chain rule differentiation, then e to the power I theta 1, plus differentiation of this one, which is root rho 1 I times e to the power I theta 1, that is differentiation of an exponential times theta 1 dot. So, this is my left hand side. This is equal to q V by 2 root rho 1 e to the power I theta 1 plus k times root rho 2 e to the power I theta 2. Now, I could repeat that. So, this is my equation number 1. I could repeat the same without having really to do any calculation, because the equations are very symmetric. So, I have rho 1 going to rho 2, this is equal to, now there was a minus sign on the second equation, and rho 1 becomes equal to rho 2. This is my second equation. Now, what do I do with this equation? So, one of the things that you do with this equation is that take the real and the imaginary part. You have two equations here. So, notice this e to the power I theta 1 is right as cosine theta 1 plus I sine theta 1, etcetera. Now, these two equations separate their real and imaginary. So, total, since I have got two equations and each I will get a real and imaginary part. So, it is something like this. Let me write down one equation here. So, I have got I h cross 1 by 2 square root of rho 1 dot cos theta 1 plus I sin theta 1, that is my e to the power I theta 1, plus root rho 1 I times cos theta 1 plus I sin theta 1. It is important that you keep track of all the i's properly, because otherwise you will miss out that this is actually a real. This is equal to q v by 2 root rho 1 again cos theta 1 plus I sin theta 1 plus k square root of rho 2 cos theta 2 plus I sin theta 2. And you can immediately do that. For example, let us look at some part, let us say the imaginary part here. This is an imaginary part because there is an I outside. So, I get 1 by h cross minus sign, because I into I is minus 1, 2 root rho 1 cos theta 1 rho 1 dot. Another imaginary part is this one, root rho 1 cos theta 1, like that. You can do that. Q v by 2 square root of rho 1 sin theta 1 plus k square root of rho 2 sin theta 2. So, this is one equation. Write down the second equation, okay, and do some algebraic manipulation. Come back to this point. This is absolutely trivial, and this can be very easily done. So my equations, which I wrote down, and once you separate them, so what you have to do is to manipulate these four to get an expression for rho 1 dot, rho 2 dot, theta 1 dot, and theta 2 dot. Now you will find that you can write them in terms of theta 1 minus theta 2, and you can see why, because you have to eliminate, see, from this equation you need to eliminate equations which are connected with theta 2 and things like that. So you get four equations, as I told you, but written in a particular fashion. So 2 by h cross k square root of rho 1 rho 2 sin delta. This one I write down blindly, because I know there is a minus sign difference. And similarly, theta 1 dot and theta 2 dot. Now, what is actually happening is this, that look at this equation, rho 1 dot is this, rho 2 dot is this. So, this is my all the four equations. Now, if you compare these two expressions, you notice rho 1 dot is equal to minus rho 2 dot. Now, the thing is, you should have actually expected this relationship, because rho 1 dot is the changing, I have connected them by something, is the changing density, if you like, of the left hand side. Rho 2 dot is the changing density of the right hand side. So, what is actually happening is this, that now if you now say that, look, what is this quantity? Now, this is some constant, let us say 2 by h cross k square root of rho 1 rho 2 dot, I have called that j 0. So, rho 1 dot equal to minus rho 2 dot, because this is minus of this, equal to j naught sin delta, where delta is theta 2 minus theta 1. Now, you would immediately say, well, this is obvious, because each one must remain the same. So, the thing is this, that what is interesting about is this, that I need to worry about what is the consequence thereof. But before I do that, see, remember this equation is extremely simple. Rho 1 dot is nothing but j, because that is the current which is coming from the left hand side. That must be the current which is leaving the right hand side, which is must be minus rho 2 dot. So, both of them being equal and opposite is understandable. And this current density j is some j naught, which is given by this coupling constants, times sin delta. So, my equation for the Josephson junction is at this moment j equal to j naught sin delta, which is an extremely simple equation. Now, if you did the same thing with theta 1 dot and theta 2 dot, they are absolutely trivial equations, so you can solve them like this. Now, let us look at what is my delta then, because I define delta as theta 2 minus theta 1. So, delta dot is theta 2 dot minus theta 1 dot. And if you look at this, when you subtract them, the complicated term cancels out, and you are left with theta 2 dot minus theta 1 dot is equal to q v by h cross, which tells me delta of t is some constant of integration plus q by h cross v t dt. Okay. Now comes the interesting part. Supposing I have applied a DC voltage, constant voltage across the junction. V is constant. If V is constant, delta of t has the solution, it is delta 0 plus q by h cross into vt. Notice one thing, vt, sorry, into v into t, because if v is constant, then this is v times t. Now, if I apply such a voltage, this tells me that I have a q by h cross there. I have a q by h cross there, but h cross, as you know, is a very small quantity. So, since h cross is small quantity and q, which is the effective charge of the Cooper pair, is 2 times E, what you get when you write J naught sin delta, this is the expression that we just now derived. So, suppose I look at this expression, that if I have a voltage, constant voltage, then the argument which comes in with t, multiplicative factor of t, is extremely large because h cross is small, even E by h cross is small. Now, E by h cross is very large, in which case the argument of sign will fluctuate very rapidly and the average value of this sine function will become 0. What is surprising about it? What is surprising about it is that if I apply a DC voltage to the ends of a Josephson junction, I find that the current is 0. What is more interesting is, supposing you do not apply any voltage, this term V is 0, then you find my current will be constant because this delta 0 is the phase difference between the two sides. And so, this can take any value between plus J naught to minus J naught depending upon what the value of delta 0 is. Now, this is very surprising because what we are saying is that in the junction, if I apply a DC voltage, I do not get a current, but if I do not apply a voltage, I have a current. The last thing that I want to talk about is the following, that suppose instead of a DC voltage, I were to apply an AC voltage. That is, there is a DC part which we have seen will become 0 and there is a small amplitude, but cosine omega t type of thing. Now, I can do that integration of delta t, delta dot t, because it is a cosine function, and you get a term like this. Then I find out what is sin delta by the usual sin a plus b equal to sin a cos a sin b formula, and find a situation like this. This one I have just now interpreted, but what is additional here is a term like this. So, now what happens is this, that if you were to control your value of omega in such a way that if my omega happens to be q v 0 by h cross, then if you expand that cosine here, you will find a term which will be also be cosine a plus b is cos b minus sin a sin b. So, in the second term minus sin a sin b, there would be another term which is a sin omega t. Now, if that happens, I get a sin square omega t, whose average, as we know, is not 0, but is half. So, therefore, the second term gives me an alternating current, provided my omega is suitably adjusted to give me a resonance condition, and such signals have actually been experimentally verified. I will stop it because we have exceeded the time. Please send me the questions, because I see a lot of questions. But I have actually already taken one extra class on superconductivity than I originally meant to, but I will see that we will shorten the optics a little bit and try to answer your questions. Thank you very much.